Hello, if there's anyone watching. I'm using a new microphone, so if the recording is a bit loud or distorted, let me know and I can swap back to my original. Just trying this one out. I'm just making a little wash that I'm going to use on all the recesses and the white areas on the cell Drake. Its underbelly, so the fleshy parts on the underbelly and its back and its neck are white. So they've been shaded very basically using an airbrush, so they have a little bit of grey just in the darker areas, but I'm gonna go over this with a wash to glaze it down and get some nice shadowing in there, and then I'm gonna highlight it over with white. So today I'm gonna be mostly doing white with this guy, and then also doing the neck, for instance. There's all these tiny little wires inside the fleshy tubes, so I'm gonna be painting those gold. This is one of those figures that takes a huge amount of effort before it suddenly starts coming together. So I'm gonna just focus on this for tonight. So I'm using glazing agent mixed with Nuln oil, just to help glaze in some shadows here. Evening. Yeah, they've got really funny looking little legs as well. Hang on. I love her little legs. Lovely looking model. Really, really like it. No, not much meat at all on them. It's quite a surprisingly small figure. When you take off the huge wings, you see how tiny it is. But it's a beautiful design. I really, really like the Heldrakes. It's the first time I've had a chance to paint one. I'm really looking forward to it. Just darkening the little areas that have these little metal pieces coming through because I'll be painting them gold later on. So, get a little bit of darkness in the recesses there before I start highlighting the white. I already did actually highlight it with the airbrush, but I want to bring it up to a really bright white and it's not quite as bright as I want it yet. It looks like a weird little face actually from this side. When you're looking at it, it looks like a little monster face. Oh no, it's the opposite of fun. It really is. And the problem is as well that I can't just see I'm repainting the trim black. I'm repainting the trim black so that when I begin the gold layers over it, it's got a layer of black against like all along the little edges in here to get you a bit of contrast, and it's a real pain. So I have to edge highlight everything black, then start the actual painting to get it gold. So there's a lot of time, but it's definitely gonna look really good when it's finished. So I made a post about it yesterday that this is the kind of figure that just takes ages to reach the point where I'm beginning to get happy with how it looks. Because all I have down at the moment are the really base layers. So she's got quite a while to go. Gonna be an ugly duckling for a good few hours and then she'll become a beautiful flying swan. Yeah, sarcasm indeed. The customer scheme is really interesting actually. I really like it. It's a Tzeentch. It's gonna be a Tzeentch Heldrake. So the blues that are down on it are to match the blues his Tzeentch army uses, so the exact same blues basically. And then I'm trying to do the same overall scheme on top of that, so white, pink, and gold. And it's the undercoat on it was, you see, this arrived half painted. The customer started on it and then realized he didn't have time to get this ready for when he needs it for a competition. So the undercoat is everything. It was blue, it had grey bits. This pink hasn't been touched, so this pink was there already. So I'm repainting it. The good thing is that the airbrush has such an incredibly light coverage that you can paint over something that's pre-painted and you're not going to lose any of the any of the detail, because the airbrush just puts on such an incredibly fine layer of paint. It's great. What I'm doing now is I'm just emphasizing these shadows a little bit with my new best friend glazing. I'm also eating quite a lot of this glaze, so probably gonna be a bit sick. But oh well. I don't have any Turkish delight. I wish I did. It would really, really help this situation. Just, you see my new little chat filter? It's gonna make the YouTube export of this make a little bit more sense now. Just a little bit. I don't have any coffee here, by the way. I've learned that lesson. I only have a bottle of water, so there's no way to stick the paintbrush into it. I'm sure I'm still gonna manage somehow, mind you. So no, you make perfect sense. So what was I about to say? So yeah, the base coat for this is kind of a mishmash of everything. So it took a while to get a coherent shade with the airbrush because, you know, it wasn't coating over the same color. But I think I got there in the end. Like, it looks the base colors are looking okay now. So it's really just a case of washing in all these little shadowed areas over and over with the glaze. I still can't believe I spent so long not glazing, by the way. No. Years. Years and years. It was only by watching Painting Buddha videos I realised, oh, hang on. That just seems complicated. It's not really. This really looks like a horrible little mouse head with a pink tongue. It's gross. Yeah, this is what I was talking about in that post I made yesterday, about how I get quite frustrated sometimes and I have to start getting a little bit of detail down. The blue on the wing with the trim looks good because it has a trim. The difference that makes to how your eye takes in this detail is unbelievable. I mean, on this side, there's a very basic version of that down. And even this side, which doesn't have the points done, the little edges aren't done, but the main areas are. This side looks so much worse than this side that has edging done. Soon as those edges are down, you see the colour of the blue. And without it, it gets lost in your eyes. You can't really see what the colour of what you're painting, and that's what frustrates me, so that's why I had to get some colours down on this as soon as possible so I could kind of get a better idea of how it was looking. Because before, I mean, last night, this was literally entirely blue. There was nothing else. The whole figure was just blue with a little bit of white. So I said, right, that's that now. I need to get some contrast down so I can actually understand what's happening here. Yeah, glazing as opposed to washing, because if like I mean, this is a wash, this is null null, but I've added a glazing agent to it so that it's easier to paint as a glaze, because a glaze has the consist like washes don't have the consistency of paint really. They've got the consistency of a wash, which is it has a surface tension designed to run into the creases, which is obviously what you want it to do. But by adding a little bit of glazing agent to it, you stop it behaving that way. I mean, it still behaves that way a little bit, but not as much. So you can use it a little bit more as a paint. And that's the trick with glazing, that you paint it on in the areas you want it in very carefully. So it works very differently to a null, like an actual wash. Like even in the few minutes I've been painting this, I'm sure you can see the difference in the shade, the shadowing on it. If that was just wash, it doesn't work as well because you can't really control it. Yeah, that's exactly what it is, that you need the dark to frame the blue, because without that your eye just can't see the detail. Because there's no detail for it to see, it's just all one color. So as soon as that gets put down, as soon as you get the little frame, you get to actually see the contrast. Makes a huge difference. You can glaze with bright colours as well, but I find it's perfect for darkening things down, getting a nice smooth shadow. Haven't really tried glazing to make things brighter. Might in the future. Not on this though. It doesn't suit this. My favourite part about it is this nice big white chunk here. I don't even know how that happened. Kinda need to repaint that. Yeah, that's Minnie. That noise. Minnie, my cat, one of them. I have many beasties. Okay, let's have a look from this side. Gonna try and get as much shading down around where the tail will be as I can, because it'll be nice enough to just be able to paint that pink and just go from there. And all of these, exhaust ports will be gold, so I'm just getting the shading down around them as well, so I don't have to come back and do that later before I repaint them gold. Save a little bit of time. Yeah, painting butter is absolutely amazing for watching that kind of stuff. I mean, like, I don't know about you, but when people used to say the words glazing or two brush blending to me, or wet blending, my brain would just turn off. I'd just shut down and be like, yeah, that sounds great. And never actually go investigate it, because I thought there was no way I'd be able to do it, because it sounded really complex. And then watching painting butter just gave me a lot of. You know, when you see somebody putting a technique to use, and I mean it's filmed so well, you can really see what's going on, and it gave me a lot of confidence, so I was able to be like, hey, I'm actually going to try that now. And yeah, I've seen them use glazing to get really, really, really beautiful NMM metals, exactly like that. And non-metallic is completely, like, I haven't even touched it either. It's not something I've any interest in going for at the moment. I mean, I still haven't come close to mastering regular metals, let alone fake ones that I've painted in. But it's still very interesting to watch, and I think you get some ideas from them. Yeah, I thought that was great as well. Like, the artist has a really relaxing, nice voice, and he just talks away, but the cameraman spurs him on with some really good questions, and or like he mentions things that he's noticing as the artist is painting, and they discuss it, and it's really good. I think they're my favorite painters to watch for learning stuff. Really good. Okay, I think it's enough of a little shade now with this. Don't want anything too strong on it. I'm just gonna move on to the neck now. Neck is very complex. There's a lot going on here. The problem is as well that this guy is assembled. He's almost entirely assembled. And it really affects my ability to get him into the right position for to reach some little bits while painting. I'm trying my best. Yeah, non-metallic looks fantastic in darker contrast photographs, so like where it doesn't have much light on it. It looks absolutely amazing, but I think that real metallics do have the benefit of reacting to actual light, so you get a more natural finish. I think the whole point of NMM is that it's just such a show of skill. I mean, it looks gorgeous, but it's also a case of saying, hey, look, I am this good that I can paint on light. I can paint on a reflection, and that's the main kind of reason people use it so much, is it's a level of a great way of showing skill. I remember back when I first started seeing, it would have been, I'd say it was in the 90s, when painting chrome with NMM became like this really big thing amongst really, really, really good painters. And it was really cool. Like, they'd paint, how to paint a chrome reflection is really interesting because you have to paint on a tiny landscape picture. That's how you do it. It's really cool. And yeah, this guy, he definitely would be a bit easier without the secondary wings. They're a bit of a problem, but they're not a massive problem. Like, I'll be able to get around them, no problem. I was just very, very thankful for the airbrush, because this is the exact kind of model where being able to block in big amounts of colour and fades is pretty important. It saved me a lot of time. But that was the fast part. The long part that's going to take forever is the actual detailing. Yeah, well, that's kind of what NMM is trying to replicate, is it's making a 3D model look almost 2D in regards to how it's painted, and shows that level of skill, and that's what I love about it. I think it's just a really interesting way of getting a very unique finish. Sorry, I'm just remixing up a little bit more of this shade. Can you hear any difference in the sound, by the way? I was listening to some of the previous recordings and I could hear like it was a little bit metallic. So I'm using the microphone within this good webcam now to see how that works out. Well, that's good. That was very suspicious, those sounds last time. It's like, who's connecting what to Wi-Fi outside, considering that the window is on the second floor and outside is a field? Was it a tractor? Just don't know. Wi-Fi tractor, a Bluetooth planting machine. Bet they exist. Okay, well, maybe I'll do some testing myself later on and listen to headsounds. I don't know why I find that idea so funny. Bluetooth tractor. Okay, I'm gonna just go in with pure null, just into where the wires are gonna be, just to make sure there's a nice black edging around the front and end of each of these little sections, because that'll help get a bit of contrasting in when I do the gold. Honestly, a little bit disturbed by how much this end looks like a little monster. It's not right. No, I won't be using the alcohol gold for this because I kind of have very specific color instructions for him, because he's to match the existing army as well as possible. So I'm not using the liquid gold because it has a very unique finish, like a really unique finish in comparison to the Citadel stuff. So with this guy, he's getting tinny or what's it called? Warplock Bronze as a base. Warplock Bronze is amazing. It's like a more advanced version of Tinny Tin, and Tinny Tin was my favourite Vallejo colour for a long time. So yeah, it gets a base of Warplock for the gold, and then I'll bring it up to, what's it called? Looking for the colour. Oh, I don't have it out actually. I think it's Gehenna's. I can't remember, but I'll work it up to a very, very silvery gold almost at the edges. But I leave a lot of the bronze showing underneath. Get that nice rich red. Yeah, Tin Bits was amazing. And then it vanished and I was really upset, and Vallejo released Tinny Tin. Well, they didn't release it, they had it the whole time. So I moved on to Tinny Tin and I was very happy. But then Warplock came along, and I Warplock's fantastic, really good stuff. I'm just, again, being quite messy here because I'm just getting the recesses with pure null here because these are going to be metallic. So I want nice dark recesses between it and the white. And maybe a little bit around here as well. I actually went to my local store to buy some new DW Metallics today, and they had none. Like, literally none. I was like, what the hell? They had Baltazar, I think it's Baltazar Gold, and nothing else. I was like, hey, no. My local is incredibly strange. My local is a news agent in the shopping centre near here. For some reason has a little Games Workshop stand. It's the most random thing. This is the same shopping centre that had that Stormtrooper next to the Sliding Wardrobes store that I showed on Facebook today. So it's a bit of a weird place. But yeah, they have this little tiny, tiny Games Workshop section where they have like, they have like a Titan there. I don't know why. I don't know who the hell is going to buy that Titan in a tiny newsagent's. It's very strange. But they didn't have anything I wanted. It was a Titan. I don't know why it's there. It's the weirdest little tiny store in the world. It's just a rack. One rack with Games Workshop stuff on it. Some of it's really out of date. Don't know. It's all like full price as well. Some of it's really out of date. They have a selection of paints. Like 5 paintbrushes. I really don't understand why it's there. I mean, this is a newsagent in like a country shopping centre. Really weird. Games Workshop must have like contacted their manager or something and offered a stall or a stand, and they said, yeah, that sounds like a great idea. And now they have all this product that is never going to sell, ever. Oh no, I mean I work in the city centre of Dublin, so I mean I could just go to the main GW there anytime. It's just on the weekend I'm not going to go into the city centre for paint. I assumed that they might have, gold of some sort, but they really had nothing. Uh-oh, way too much wash. Yeah, ordering stuff is definitely an option for me in general. But I'm lucky enough that there is the big Games Workshop in the middle of town. Okay, so that's basically done for this part anyway. I'm just going to use some of the leftover wash to increase the shadowing in some of these little sections. Okay, I'd say next after this I'm gonna. Oh, see, this is the thing with this figure. It's actually hard to know what to do. Like normally I'd have a game plan of, oh, I'm gonna do this color and then I'm gonna do this section and then I'm gonna do this section, but this figure is just so busy. There's so much going on with it that it's hard to know what I should be doing next, even though normally I wouldn't even have to think about that. I'd say I will do. I want to do something that's gonna make an actual difference and make me feel like I'm progressing a little bit, so I might do the gold. Well, the base coat of the gold. Neaten that up. Get it into these little recesses. Or I could do the highlight of white. Oh, there's no such thing as a spot of wind framework, I tell you. Let me think. I do actually need to. I do need to tidy up. There's some places where a little bit of overspray happened. For instance, if I bring this up, you might see it. You can see where I'm pointing at here with the brush. There's a little bit of white got sprayed onto the plates here. So there's little areas like that need to be tidied. I could do those very quickly. It'll be quite easy as well because I'm just gonna glaze that down, to be honest. Some gully man. And once it's dyed blue again, I'll go over it with some midnight blue mixed with a little bit of black as another glaze, because that's what the base coat color is anyway, and the base color is the part that got a little bit of spray over on it. So I'm just quickly changing the tone from being white to blue, which is going to make covering it a little bit easier, and then I'll go over it. It's the same here. I think I got a little bit of, yeah, a little tiny bit of copper oversprayed here, so I'm just going to keep tidying that up. I'll just reglaze it over and over until it gets covered, which actually won't take that long. I'm going to do a touch up again of the actual blue. It's actually really frustrating because I thought I had these sections perfectly masked. Yeah, see, the thing is, I had them masked, but I made a mistake in just on these two pieces, just on that little bit of the neck, and there, everything else was perfect. I don't know how I made that. I don't know how I did that, to be honest. It was a weird thing for me to miss. I may have accidentally moved it with my finger. These things happen. That's why I always airbrush as the first layer, so I have more time and more layers to fix things if I make any mistakes. It's pretty important. Just quickly checking my PMs. It's actually a little tiny there as well. Okay, I'm going to leave those bits to dry because they're actually going to take quite a while. I'm going to go on to detailing a bit more with the gold. So I'm going to get all the little recessy bits done. Where is it? So this is Warp Black Bronze. Absolutely gorgeous. I use it for all of my gold bases that aren't real gold. I have tinny tins somewhere as well, hiding away, because I only have the one pot of it left, so that's sacred at this point. Yeah, there's little kids outside. The whole back area of this complex is well, over to one side is a very big family park with it's a wildlife preserve as well as being a family park, which is amazing. So there's always like little kids running around and playing, but they're really good kids, so they're fine. Oh, so many little spikes getting caught in my gloves. Yeah, I always recommend Warblock as a great base. If you're doing super detailed gold, I find base coating the areas that you're painting the gold on with a deep brown before you paint any metal over it makes it really helps. Warblock for me is the brown because this is the base layer. I've painted metallic golds using only silver and washes, and they were beautiful. Like some of the nicest gold I've ever painted. However, it takes so long. Oh my God. Like you're talking like 15, 20 layers, maybe? I saw Games Workshop recently released what they call gem paints, which I think are very silly. It's just transparent paint. I kind of understand why it's a good start for someone who isn't used to painting gems or is intimidated. But it would be a much better idea to release little three packs of paint that, a base coat, a main colour, and a highlight colour with a little guide on how to drop it on to create a teardrop shape and get a really nice gem. So I think the gem paint they released is a little bit of just like, hey guys, we don't care. This is gems, quote unquote. Yeah, it's like Tamiya Clear, but it's not as good. So it's like, I don't know. I just feel like it's a bit of a cash in. I think it's a very needless, like, there was no necessity for that release. And I want to start doing I have my website is. I've got a couple of pages live on it now. The main one will be the blog, and I want to start doing product reviews on it. And I was thinking, oh, I guess I could do one on those gem paints, but then I was like, I really don't want to. Don't want to do it. Yeah, that's the thing. I'm pretty sure using those paints outside of their intended use is going to be the way of getting good results with them. I think what they are going to be very good for is getting coloured metallics, like a proper sheen on a coloured metallic, because while you can, like, I've got metallic medium here that you can mix into any paint to create a metallic version of it, but it just makes it pearlescent. It doesn't make it, it doesn't have that reflectiveness. And what I think that those gem paints, what I think they'll be really good for is people making colourful metallic armies. So, like, base coating them in a silver and then painting that over them. I think we're going to see some silver transparent blood angels. So blood angels that are silver and have been painted with that red gem paint. Like, people have been doing that with Tamiya Clear, but it's a bit painstaking. And I think now that, especially, like, because that isn't even available in a lot of countries, but this GW paint will be easily obtainable. And I think we're gonna see Blood Angel armies that are just beautiful, like red over silver. I've been thinking about doing one myself, actually. It would work quite well for some corn units as well. But I think Blood Angels more than anything. You could also, if there were more versions of it, you could, if there were more colours available, sorry, of the gem paint, you could do interesting things with stuff like black-based models, like painting a transparent oily purple over them to get a kind of aliens look. There's a few things I can think of using it for. But I just think the intended use of painting it over something silver and saying, "Oh, look, it's a gem," I don't think that works at all. I think it'll look really bad. Because it doesn't look like a gem. Like, there's nothing about it that looks like a gem. It just looks like shiny metal. And the whole point of when you're painting gems as a miniature is to trick the eye into thinking that it is a piece of glass, something 3D. People will find a use for them. People find uses for everything that gets released. I just don't think it's gonna be for painting gems. Yeah. I don't. I mean, I like that they're kind of just, releasing more than extremely basic paints. But Some of them are very odd. Like, do you remember those? I got really irritated when they released those Edge paints. It was just like, all these are paints that already exist, and you've added a little bit of white to them so people can use them to edge highlight. I mean, how can you justify that by saying, yeah, this is a paint specific for edging? It's not. And they have a lot of stuff like that that's just odd choices. Yeah, it just has white added. That's it. Just trying to. She has a completely hollow body, Eldrake. I'm just trying to get this in as far as I can. Yeah. Gold base. She's still blue in there. There we go. Nice. Now, on to these bits. I could have actually airbrushed her guts in. Now I look at it, yeah. But I mean, most of the holes that she has at the moment are gonna be filled up with her legs and stuff, so that's not so bad. Yeah, the secondary wings being attached is a bit of a pain in the bum. I mean, they're not that bad. They could definitely be a lot worse when it comes to blocking off segments, that's for sure. But they're just a little bit awkward. I'm getting used to them now. My partner to get me a coffee. He's gonna go get make some. Need a coffee and not to stick my brush in it this time. Well, it's really amazing how, like, as soon as you start putting on any kind of detail, it's like, oh, whoa. Whoa, now I can see the grey. It's exactly what I was saying earlier. See, now that this part is done, now I can see that grey better. So interesting. There's so many mind tricks with painting. And yeah, I'm seeing like a horrifying Minnie Mouse here. It's really horrible. It's horrible. These ears. Have you seen this light I'm building? It's disgusting. I was like, okay, I've got this beautiful high-end platform CMS. What will I do? I'm gonna make a website, but I want it to be disgusting and look like I made it in the 90s, but it costs a lot of money. That's exactly what I'm doing. It's the most eye-glaring thing in the world, but I love it. The ears are her hips. Ears are where her little legs stick on. That's why I'm not painting inside them, there's no point. I'm gonna be covered up. Yeah, it's disgusting. It's the most 90s nonsense in the world. Hang on, I'll get you a link for it. I only have three pages made in it. The other pages that I'm working on the back end are way more complex, so I'm not. They're not ready to go live yet. I'm gonna try and code in. Well, I'm not gonna do the coding because I don't have a clue, but I'm gonna ask my friend to help me code in a Twitch stream within the website. That'd be cool, so I can like have archived videos playing in there and stuff. Have some interesting features like that in mind. I have a Twitter stream integrated into it at the moment, but that's not on one of the live pages. And the blog page I'm working on is set up for to auto share everything I post across all my social media, which is gonna be really, really handy. Oh my God, this is making it so much worse looking now. It really looks like eyes. Ew. Mean, it was bad prior to this, but now it's disgusting. I'm gonna. Well, see, the system I'm using, IFTTT, how it works is it can only interact with systems it has API keys for. So like it works for Facebook, so I can make it like sync up with Facebook, and whenever I post anything on Facebook, posts on everything else for me. But there's some things it can't work out how to do. Like if I share something on Facebook, it can't pull up that information. I have to make the actual post. Whereas with the website I'm working on, it's integrated with everything already. So I can attach my accounts into it manually, which I've done, and then set it so whenever I make any blog post, it itself auto shares. Not like creates a new post, but actually shares directly onto the other sites, which looks a bit nicer. I'm probably going to use both. So, like, if I'm posting something directly on Facebook, I'll use IFTTT, and if I'm posting something on the blog on the new site, it'll auto share from its own systems. I'll have a chat with him. We have to be careful to not. I mean, there'd be ways to make it. Ooh, I went out of focus. There'd probably be ways to make it, but see, it's. I mean, I work for Squarespace, and it's a Squarespace site, and he works for Squarespace, so I don't want to be like, hey, let's code this into the site, and it's actually a security risk. You know? So, I'll have a chat with him and see what the story is. I mean, if it's possible, it would be absolutely awesome as well, because that's the one thing, like, IFTTT cannot do that. It can't in any way interact with DACA. Or I'd use it. I'm not sure. I mean, we might be able to get it to. use my login info for Docker, but even then, see, it wouldn't be logging in and making the post. It should, what it will need to be able to do is have my Docker account on file and have itself set as a, what's the term? It would have itself registered as, you know, an allowed poster on my behalf. Docker doesn't have that feature. So I don't think it would be the site that would be the problem. Whoop! You knocked over everything. I think it would be the fact that Docker doesn't have that as a setup. It doesn't allow anything to post on your behalf. And posting on your behalf is what it would have to do. It wouldn't be able to just share onto it. So it's complex, but I mean, it'd be worth having a look at. I'm really happy with how different this looks now as soon as those details went on. I'm going to start the details on the neck. Well, actually, I'm going to tidy up all around here. I don't know if you can see very well. It's very, very messy around here. Nothing is finished. Like the gold doesn't connect here. The background isn't done. This is the downside of the airbrushing. It's like I was saying on the post today, I love airbrushing. I really, really do. But it's not as neat as people assume it is when you're using a basic, I mean, even with a high-end airbrush, it's not, it's very hard to be very neat. And with my airbrush, which is just like basic, it I mean, I'm used to using it, but that doesn't mean I'm able to do detail work with it. It's just not capable, doesn't have enough control. All these little vents still have blue in them as well, so tidy them up. Oh, getting in there is going to be really difficult to get the gold in without hitting any of the blue that's under there. Yeah, if I can get it to auto log in for me and create the post, then it would work, but I'm really not sure. I don't even think Squarespace would have that functionality, and I don't want to put the site into developer mode because I don't have the skills. I wouldn't know how to run a dev site. Been buffering, has it? How long has it been running? About half an hour, I think. Yeah, it would make sense. My stream, let's have a look. The stream quality is grand. Don't think I'm dropping anything. I'm dropping about, actually, yeah, I'm dropping a fair few. I'm dropping about 15%. That's quite a lot. Let's keep an eye on that. I might need to restart soon anyway, just so I have a nice and small video to export. Ooh, sorry, I feel like I need to sneeze. Alright, just gonna start on the neck. All the little tubes. Tubies. Yeah, let me know if it does. I mean, I'm dropping some frames, but not enough for it to be struggling. Thanks. What, this part? Ooh. Oh, it's so horrible. Looks like it was rejected from a kid's theme park. A sip of this coffee. No. Okay, so I'm just gonna keep pushing with the wires in the neck to get them matching the rest of the bronze. This really is an incredibly confusing figure. It's so funny. It's like when I'm holding it like this, it looks like it could be like some kind of squid monster that flies at you that way. When in reality, it's like this. With the head on that end. So weird. Look, this side is like a horrible Minnie Mouse.
That looks pretty horrifying.
Oh, cats. So, get this on. Her head is here. So you can kind of. See the shape there. The head's gonna be really interesting to work on as well because it's extremely detailed. It doesn't look it, but it actually is. Okay, so keep going this way. I'm very slowly also shading in the actual metal parts along the trim of the neck here to get them in, because there's no point in not doing that. No, he wouldn't understand, he's deaf. He would just look at me quizzically, wondering why I was waving something at him. I've seen these painted in really interesting ways, but I've also seen them, because before I started painting this guy, I was looking at some YouTube videos for like different ways people got nice effects on the wings and stuff, because I wanted to kind of have some ideas laid out straight away for the owner. And it's amazing how many people buy and paint these and skip like 90% of the detail on them. Just paint it all one colour. And it's a shame because it's a really, really nice model and it has a lot of opportunity for colour and getting an interesting finish on it. So I'm really happy that the owner is actually like quite into the idea of it having a few colours and having some fades. If you're paying, you know, I think this thing is about $70. I'm not sure. It's not cheap. If you're paying that much money for something, why would you ignore so much of the detailing on it, you know? I mean, you paid for a really detailed figure. What I absolutely love about the Warblock bronze base is how it's immediately so reflective. There's no, you don't have to put on a couple of layers. It's just straight away, completely metallic, completely reflective. It's great stuff. And it works really, really well as a base because it's so dark. It can nearly blackline with it. In fact, I may actually skip blacklining. If this works well, I might not blackline the rest of the figure and just use Warblock, which is gonna take off an extra two layers of detailing. Well, extra one layer of detailing that may not be needed actually, if this works. So I'm gonna try it out on the neck. Because this figure needs to be finished for a specific date. So it actually has a timer. And there's a couple more coming, it's not just this one. This is the first one of a set of either three or four, if I can get them finished. So the faster I can get them finished with a really nice finish, the better. So if I can use the Warblock instead of black to blackline, I'll be really happy. So I'm just going to see how that goes. Because that's going to save me quite a lot of time. I'm sorry for this is going to be a bit of a weird bit of the video because I have to keep turning it and it's so tall that there's no way the camera's going to be able to get that in focus. Excuse me? Who made that noise? Goodness. Little beast. Do you want to come up here and paint? Yeah? Come on. Okay. You just need to get your paws. Come on. No duty. Come on, focus. Yeah. Give it a sniff. You're useless. You're useless. Go away. She was useless. Yeah. Well, yeah, it is a fair amount more. I think it's 70, about 75. When I went to the GW site to check, and I remember being around that mark. Yeah, she's my little painting gremlin. I use her. She does all the base coating for me. Just dipper. That's how I actually do a lot of painting. I just dip in some army painter dip, and then I just hit her against the models until they look good. Works well. No, that's nice. It's crazy how much of a difference the red undertone of the warp lock makes against the blue. It's like, oh wow, hang on, color contrast. Where have you been all my life? Ooh, it's hard to know if I should black line with this or not. It's very subtle, the differences between the two, but there is a subtle difference. I'm probably going to go around all the edges of these plates with another dark glaze though, so it's kind of gonna black line itself. I just really don't want to do that thing I'm guilty of where I spend a lot of time on layers that are just absolutely pointless because they're going to be covered up later on. I do it all the time. And every time I do it, I go, oh god, you've got to learn from that. Don't do that again. And then I do it again anyway because I didn't learn. This may be the first time I will have learned and not have done it. Duty's hairs. Don't want that here. Go away. No. Because this area under here is white, it's really important that I very carefully make sure that the edges of the armor plates are very well defined against it. If I don't, you're gonna have all those horrible little white flaky bits in between. So I'm just being very careful with this one part, even though I'm gonna end up covering this with four or five more layers. I think painting the Carnifex, or not Carnifex, sorry, the Hive Tyrant just before I painted this has made a big difference to my understanding of when it's okay to be a bit messier with a layer, because I was way too neat with that hive tyrant on every layer, and there was no need considering that. I mean, on the stripes alone, I think I did 7 layers. Jesus, yeah, 6 or 7 layers. So why was I, you know, like, there was no need to be as precise as I was on the earlier layers. And so it's the same with this Warplock bronze is the first of like 6 layers. So there's no point in being stressed out with any little missed bits. Flappy is nearly finished, very, very, very close to being finished, but I'm working on this lady until, what I'm going to do is I'm going to work non-stop on her until I burn out. So until I'm like, I don't want to paint this right now. And then I'm going to jump on and finish Flappy because he's, you know, he's something different. And that'll give me the motivation then come back and finish this off, because I really want to make sure this gets finished on time, obviously. Also, bought these today. I'll show you them. These are absolutely amazing gloves. Way better than the previous ones I was using, because these are like surgery, latex surgery gloves. So they're just way more comfortable and give much better grip. And they're great for this kind of thing, because I can keep my hands nice and free of touching the model. Makes a big difference. Little black cat that I showed you a minute ago is she's lying on the floor next to me, but she's lying on her back with all four legs in the air. I'm trying to get some attention from me, because I'm ignoring her. Yes, these are powder free. It's 100 pairs for €20. So these will last me a year, because I mean, I would reuse them. They don't exactly get dirty. You can get them in most any decent pharmacy will have surgical gloves for, you know, not too expensive. You can order them online for probably way cheaper as well, but you know, I said no way. Saw them in the store today. Yeah, that's what she's doing. She does that when she wants to look cute, and she's hoping that someone's going to come over and rub her belly for her. No, I'll tell you what, she doesn't do that. She's completely non-aggressive. If she rolls over and asks you to rub her tummy, she wants you to rub her tummy. And she just lies there and stretches out and purrs and lets you rub her tummy for ages. I don't think she's ever in her life gotten irritated with a human. But she's a little bit special. She's a failed foster, basically. We were fostering a little, well, not even fostering, we rescued a little pregnant street cat. And when she gave birth, I was the only one in the house I was trying to help her through it, but I didn't want to interfere too much because I kind of, you know, just wanted her to get along with it on her own. But the first little kitten was the little black one. And when she was born, the mum kind of didn't fully know what to do, so she started cleaning her, but she cleaned her from her bum forward instead of from her face. So her little face was covered by like the film they're in when they're born. She wasn't breathing, and I left it as long as I could, and I said, no, I've got to interfere here. So I picked her up and I pulled the film off her face, and I was swinging her over my shoulder trying to get her to breathe, and she didn't breathe for well over 5 minutes, and then she gasped. She was okay. But she's always been, I think she's a little bit brain damaged. She's very, very, very slow to react to anything. But is also the sweetest, kindest, most gentle little thing I've ever owned. She's a special girl. That looks really nice. Look at the difference that makes on that blue. Even though it's got like the little white mistakes down the bottom that I'm gonna fix, you can really like see the blueness of it now. So the model is starting to come out of hiding now, the colours are starting to come out of hiding, which is such a lovely moment. Lots of little tiny hard to reach places. I'm not going to use this brush to reach them because I'm going to damage the brush. Oh yeah, she's not an outdoors cat. She wouldn't be able to live outside. Not a chance. She's fully indoors. All of our cats are, because, well, first of all, we live on the second story, so she wouldn't be very, wouldn't be able to get outside very well. But one of them is deaf. She's a little bit brain damaged, so you know they've reasons why we want to keep them inside anyway. If I had if we lived somewhere not near to a, actually I'm not gonna use this brush, if we lived somewhere not near a road and we were on the ground floor, I'd let her out. I'm just using this big ass brush because I want to get right in here. Just trying to be careful to not hit any of the painted areas. That would be really bad for a brush this size. But there's loads of little areas in here I can block in nice and quick. You're not going to see these anyway because these are going to have the wing kind of comes out of this area, so it's going to cover up almost all of this. But I want to try and get it down anyway. Somebody's paint or paying you to paint a model, you should not skimp out on little things like this. Okay, that's much better. Sorry for the odd angles again, guys, just I have to turn this a bit strangely to reach in here. You can kind of see, like, in the back of some of these areas. And it, like I said a minute ago, it's one of those things where, I mean, you could leave it undone, but leaving it undone when you're being paid to paint a figure is really rude, I think. Don't be a lazy person. Also, without fail, and I do mean without fail, if you skip any areas because you're like, ah, no, I don't need to paint in there. I don't need to paint in there. You can guarantee when you go to take a photo of this later on, it'll show up. That area you skipped will be so noticeable. Oh, milestone. Let me have a look. Where is it saying this? Oh yeah, looks like it. That's cool. That's cool, guys. Even though not many people watching it today, but it is a bit late, so pretty understandable. Gonna keep going now. I've kind of just mashed in some gold into some of those areas just to try and cover them up a little bit. Even though the wings are gonna go in there. I'm just gonna keep going. So this side is about done now for the cords, the cables, and for the plates. Looks much better. It's a really big improvement for a couple of hours' work. And I'm just gonna start on the other side now. Just making sure I haven't missed any of these little spots. Yeah, missed a little bit there. I love painting big figures, but man, it really takes a lot longer than painting a single one. I know, yeah, I know, I realised that was a bit of a given point, but it's sometimes, in your mind, it seems like, well, for me, when I come up with a colour scheme, or I'm planning out a scheme in my head, I can allocate time to it, I can understand, okay, it's going to take this amount of time to do this, and then this part will take longer, but when a figure's quite big, I'm not able to do that very well. So, it always feels like it takes much longer than I was going to expect it to. But that's only because my expectations were incorrect in the first place. No. No, thanks. I've seen some beautiful Titans painted up, but they're not my cup of tea. I mean, I don't like painting. Like, in all honesty, I'm not a fan of painting 40k in general. I'm not a fan of painting a vehicle. This I like because it's quite organic. Same with the Hive Tyrant. I mean, it is organic, but I'm not a fan of, like, dreadnoughts and stuff. I just don't enjoy painting armor as much as I enjoy painting like skin. Yeah, I rode a car. I would see that as being organic. You know, like that's am I thinking of the right thing? Everblight is the kind of demonic cyborg faction, right? Oh no, wait, I'm thinking of Crix. Everblight are the big beasties. Demonic cyborgs. You know what I mean? Yeah, I know the one you're talking about. Yeah, like that's beautiful. And that's something I would like to paint. Huge though. Like absolutely huge if I remember. I love all of the War Machine sculpts, to be honest. And I love the Privateer Press paints. Or not Privateer Press, crap. So I'm getting distracted now. I remember the Archangel is absolutely huge. But beautiful. Really monstrous. I think they actually got released while I was still working for the little hobby store I used to work for, and we were really excited about getting some in. What I think is amazing about the paints is that they just hit the nail on the head for a lot of shades that people were really looking for a long time from GW and weren't getting, like a proper ceramic colour and bone and just really like cream colours. Like cream, a really good light cream is something GW has struggled with for a long time. I mean, they had bleached bone and stuff, but that's not cream. And then because War Machine has that faction in it that was almost Menoth, is it? It's like cream and red. Their paints are just so perfectly suited. I've painted up a bit of Menoth to sell on eBay. But I did it with GW paints. And I remember being like, man, trying to get this cream is so difficult. I had to mix it myself. It was just so much hassle. Bollocks. Sorry. I know you from Tumblr. I've forgotten your name. No! Ah! God. That's gonna really annoy me. Begins with D. Prove to myself that I'm not going crazy. I don't know. That noise is a little baby that lives upstairs, and they love playing with I don't even know what it is. It's like a little block or something that they just bang on the floor all day. It's so cute. It's like not annoying, it's just kind of cute. I remember painting those painting that little unit of it was like three hoppers and a big guy. I've forgotten his name, he's gorgeous. And then there was like a little tiny summoner lady and she had like red hair. They were so fun. They're still some of my probably my favorite commission I did at that level by far, because of how much fun those black carapaces were with the streaks. They were brilliant. I love them. I was actually, because I was uploading photos to my site today, and I only just uploaded those, and I was only looking at them today going, oh my god, they were so much fun. Actually, I'll grab a link and show you those arts so you know what we're talking about. But they were a lovely little unit I did. It's a bit annoying because the photos I took during that period are nothing in comparison to the photos I can take now. So like the photos aren't great, but they still get the idea across. Hang on. Carnivian, that was it. What did I just call them? Hoppers? That's completely wrong. Hoppers. What am I even thinking of? No, I haven't. You should be able to link into the chat, by the way. I changed the settings so that everyone can link. Send us a link. I really, really like the Carnivian in general. Had just such a lovely sculpt. And all of the Everblight stuff I really liked because it was all that kind of like, it had no eyes. And it was just really interesting looking. Doesn't say squid, does it? It was auto-corrected. I can't blame it, squig isn't a word. I mean, last time I checked, squig wasn't a word. I think I'm going to be able to get away with not blacklining this, to be honest. I think that looks quite neat with the black, which is excellent news. It's going to save me a lot of time and allow me to get this finished a good maybe 10 hours sooner, which is a big deal. And it's when you've got a time limit. These were certainly airbrushed. There is no way these are hand painted. let me show you for a sec. So you can, I mean, when this is finished, it'll be much harder to tell it was airbrushed. But so you can tell it was airbrushed now because when you look at like the wings, you can see how messy it is. I mean, the blue is actually just everywhere. It's the act of tidying it up with the gold that makes that look good. So that's what I'm doing now. Like when you compare that to this wing that has the black lining on it, you can see like how much neater it looks once that's on. So yeah, the blues are airbrushed. They are, the light I'm using is very reflective, very, very bright light. So it's distorting how they look a little. They're not as like glary as this. I am gonna matte down all of the panels though with Liquitex. Because I don't want them to be shiny, I want them to be really dull looking. So they're airbrushed. So on the body, you can see like the pale blue is down the center of the neck, and then it kind of darkens out on either side. And then it's like here, the pale blue is in here, and then along the edges. And then on these panels, it's in the center of each panel again, to give it that kind of nice look. I don't think you could do that by hand. Well, I mean, you could, but it would just be like the time, you know, it would take, wouldn't be worth it. Stuff like this is exactly what the airbrush is for. Do you have an airbrush? Dark amoeba. I'm gonna call you Dark Amoeba. That's all you get. Okay. Just checking. I think I'm actually gonna start some detailing work on the head. Leave the body just over there for a minute. Yeah, they're weird. Airbrushes are weird because you just have to slowly learn how to use them, and like, it's really common for the first things you paint to look like absolute crap. So don't feel bad about that. Mine, I remember that, like, the very first figures I painted were the red fire warriors. No, what are they called? Oh, 2 hours. Oh, thank you, Dicex. I'm just gonna restart the stream, guys. It's just if I keep it under 2 hours, I can upload it to YouTube in half the time that it would take normally. So I'm just gonna restart it. It'll go offline for about 20 seconds, and it's gonna come back up. And I'll try and remember what I was just talking about because I've already forgotten. Okay, back up in a moment.